In this video, we are going to be talking about our blood vessels. We have two types of blood vessels in our body. We have the veins and we have the arteries. In a simple way, veins can be defined as any blood vessels that are transporting blood towards the heart. Whereas our arteries, we can define them as any blood vessels that are transporting blood away from the heart. So we are going to start by first of all looking at the structure of our veins and the arteries. We want to find out the structure of the veins and arteries. So we are going to start with the structure of the arteries. First of all, we are aware that arteries are moving blood at a high pressure. Blood is at high pressure. It is going to be pumped by the left side of the ventricle, even to the aorta, finally to the distributory arteries. First of all, to the conducting arteries, to the distributory arteries, and so on. We also have other arteries that is radiating from the right side of the heart. That is the pulmonary artery. So, in simple terms, one best way of looking at this is just to have the sense that we have two types of saturation. We have the systemic saturation, which is moving blood from the heart to the body and back to the heart. So, from the left side of the heart to the body and back to the right side of the heart. Then, we have the pulmonary saturation, where the blood is moving from the right side of the heart, being pumped by the right ventricle, to the lungs to pick oxygen, and back to the left side of the heart. So, we can start looking at this. I'm going to start with the side of arteries. An artery, all arteries are moving blood at high pressure. Blood is at high pressure. So, in general, the artery is made of an open inside. The inside is open. It's an open tube. And it is considered as the lumen. So, we have a lumen. And then we have an inner muscle, inner layer, which is a little bit thin. So, here we have the lumen. Then we have the inner layer, which is a little bit thin. So, this inner layer, which is thin, is the one which we call the tunica interna or tunica intima. All the layers of blood vessels are called tunica. So, the layers of blood vessels are called tunica. So, here we have our tunica interna. Followed by the tunica interna, we have a thicker layer. The arteries have a thicker layer, which is after the tunica interna. And this layer, this one, is known as the tunica media. It is in the middle, tunica media. So, tunica interna, this one, because it is internal. Tunica media, because it is in the middle, tunica media. Then, we finally have an outer layer, which is a little bit thinner. And this outer layer, which is thinner, is the one which we call tunica externa. Why? External. External, coming from the word external, because it is outside. Tunica externa. Or in some textbooks, it's going to be called tunica adventitia. Tunica adventitia. So, we are going to start one by one and try to find out what contents and what is made up of those layers. So, our artery, we have the innermost part, which is open. It is the lumen. This is the lumen. We have the layer that comes after the lumen, which is a little bit thin, and it is the tunica interna. So, this one, this layer here, is the tunica. So, we shall start with tunica, then interna. It is the tunica interna. So, the tunica interna is specifically made up of smooth, squamous, endothelial tissue. And with this smooth squamous endothelial tissue, we had already talked about it, that it is the same type of tissue which is lining the inside of the heart. It is the same type of tissue lining the inside of the heart. Smooth squamous epithelial tissue. It is smooth squamous endothelial. So, smooth squamous endothelial tissue. And this smooth squamous endothelial tissue, when we try to look at it on the basis of microscopic level, you would notice that it has a basement membrane in the inside part here. It has a basement membrane, and on a basement membrane, they are seated cells, our squamous cells, our smooth squamous endothelial cells, making the smooth squamous endothelial tissue, and each of them has a nucleus. So they give a smooth flow of blood. Blood can flow through the blood vessel smoothly. In the case this surface becomes rough, for example, in a puncture, if you get a puncture on your blood vessel, what will happen is that blood clotting, it will stimulate blood clotting. The rough surface will stimulate blood clotting. So chances are high a clot is going to be formed inside your blood vessel, which is highly risky. It's a risky factor. Can be so deadly, it can be so pathologic, I beg your pardon, it can be so pathologic, it can result into embolism, in case that clot formed is freed and it moves freely in the blood. Then, our internal layer is the tunica media, this one, is the tunica media. So, this tunica media is basically made up of smooth muscle, and within this smooth muscle, there are some strands of elastic fiber. So it is smooth muscle mixed up with elastic fiber in order to allow elasticity of the blood vessel. But when you try to consider larger blood vessels, you would find, for example, the conducting blood vessels, the large ones, for example, the aorta, you would probably find that it has extra lining of elastic fiber, forming a layer known as elastic lamina. So you would find elastic lamina in larger conducting blood vessels. So large blood vessels, the large ones, the main ones, can be considered as the conducting blood vessels, whereas the smaller ones may be considered as the distributary blood vessels, the arterioles. So, in the artery, we have two types of arteries. We have the conducting arteries, which are the main, and we have the distributary arteries, which are branches of the conducting arteries. So, in the conducting arteries, the main ones, the larger ones, they have extra layers of elastic lamina. So, you will find extra layers of elastic lamina here, just between the media intima or interna and the media, just between the tunica interna and the tunica media. And you would find the extra elastic lamina also, just on the lining, between the tunica externa and the tunica media. So, then the outermost layer of the artery, this outermost layer of the artery, is going to be our tunica, the outermost, is going to be our tunica externa, because it's outside, external. So, tunica externa. And it is mainly made up of some smooth muscle and some small portion of smooth muscle, but the majority of it is specifically collagen, and you find also elastic fibers within. So in the tunica externa, you will find elastic fiber strands and collagen, mainly to allow the free expansion of the artery as blood moves through it. So in these huge arteries, the conducting arteries, what is going to specifically happen is that them having extra elastic lamina, them having extra elastic lamina, is an adaptation for them to transport blood in a smooth flow, because the heart is keeping on contracting or relaxing, contracting. So we would expect blood to be moving in pulses, which may not be physiologically good. You would expect blood to be moving like this, because the heart is keeping on well contracting as it relaxes, it contracts and it relaxes. So blood will move in segments. So, but these arteries, the large conducting arteries, underwent a certain adaptation by them having extra elastic lamina fibers. That is between the tunica media and the tunica externa, and also between the tunica interna and the tunica media. This one here and here. Mainly, these elastic fibers, as the blood comes in from the heart during ventricular contraction, the blood comes in a very high pressure, so they expand. They expand. And during that time where the heart is relaxed, during ventricular relaxation, or rather ventricular diastole, they are going to push back, they will recoil back. It's like recoil. This elastic lamina has been recoiling, so the artery keeps on expanding and recoiling, expanding and recoiling. So when the heart contracts, they expand. When it relaxes, they recoil back. And that mechanism of expanding and recoiling back, expanding and recoiling, is very essential in maintaining a smooth flow of blood through our arteries, the conducting arteries. So blood will move in a smooth flow. So it will be such a pattern. They keep on maintaining the smooth flow. Now, when we consider the structure of the veins, blood is moving at a less slower pressure. In fact, the pressure, the blood pressure in the vein will approximate to zero. It will be so low. For further explanation about that, you can see the previous video, which was about blood pressure. So here, the shape will be a little bit irregular. So we have a large lumen. The lumen is larger in veins. We have a very large lumen. And just around the lumen, we have our tunica interna. The names are the same. So we have the lumen. Then we have the tunica interna. This one. It is also made up of smooth squamous endothelial tissue to aid in smooth flow of blood. Then after that, we have a thinner tunica media. So the tunica media in the veins is thinner, it is smaller, it is not as thick as that in arteries. Why? Here the veins are moving blood at a relatively low pressure. Blood is at low pressure, almost approximating to zero. In fact, it may not be zero, but it will be approximating to. Because when we talk about arteries, the blood pressure may be around 120 over 80 millimeters of mercury. Whereas in veins, we are talking of a blood pressure which is around 6 to 8 millimeters of mercury. That's very low. So the tunica media will be thinner because it does not have to overcome any pressure. Another thing, the tunica media is specifically or mainly made up of smooth muscle. Smooth muscle. It has less elastic fiber because no need for elasticity, no need to maintain a smooth flow of blood. Then we then have, so this is our tunica media. Then we have our tunica externa. So this is our tunica externa, the one which is outermost, the tunica externa, the tunica externa. Now we are going to start seeing some few differences between the veins and arteries. And the first one we talked about, we said that veins have a thinner tunica media because blood is relatively at a low pressure. So in veins, blood is at low pressure. So in the veins we have low pressure. which is around 8 to 6 millimeters of mercury. Whereas in arteries, we have high pressure. Blood is moving at a very high pressure, which is around 120 over 80 millimeters of mercury. Then, thing number two, you would consider that because in veins we have a low pressure, because in veins we have a low pressure, very low, it may not be sufficient enough to move the blood through the veins up to the heart. So veins have undergone particular adaptations in order for blood to easily move through them. And these adaptations, one of them is having of valves. So due to evolution defined veins to have valves in them. These valves prevent backflow of blood because blood it's at a relatively very low pressure, it can easily move backwards. So veins, if you look at a vein, it will have valves, and these valves will always point up the way towards the heart to prevent backflow of blood backwards. So our veins have valves. So they have valves. So valves are positive. Whereas in arteries, we have no valves. No valves. Another thing we can consider when we try to view further, I think we know why arteries do not have valves. Arteries don't have valves because blood in arteries is moving at a relatively high pressure. And we do not want to alter this pressure because we need deep pressure to create ultrafiltration at the capillary site. Because we need that ultrafiltration at the capillary site, which requires a very high pressure, we don't want to alter this high pressure by putting there blockers, valves may block, which may lower up the pressure in the arteries. Then another thing, in case you press an artery, a good example would be the branchial artery. So in case you press an artery and you apply pressure on it, in case you apply pressure on an artery against a bone, you are going to feel something, a beat. You will feel the heartbeat. That thing you will be feeling is the one we term to as a pulse. So in arteries, we have pulse. Whereas in veins, there are no pulse. Veins do not palpate. You cannot palpate a vein because in veins we don't have pulse. Blood is at a relatively very low pressure. So, no pulse. We have no pulse in veins. Then there's something we need to talk about. In most textbooks, you will find they will tell you that veins move deoxygenated blood, whereas arteries move oxygenated blood. That statement is a little bit tribal. It is correct, but it's not so accurate because we have some veins that move oxygenated blood. An example is the pulmonary vein, the one that returns blood from the lungs to the heart. It moves oxygenated blood. So it would be wrong to rule out that veins move deoxygenated blood. It depends. Veins only move deoxygenated blood if it is in the systemic saturation. So we would say that all veins in the systemic saturation move deoxygenated blood. But if we are to look at the pulmonary vein moves oxygenated blood. So we need to be certain about that. With the pulmonary saturation, because in the pulmonary saturation, we have one vein, that is the pulmonary vein, and it moves oxygenated blood from the lungs back to the heart before it's pumped to the systemic saturation. So it is not, we shouldn't rule out that veins move deoxygenated blood. No, that's not the case. It depends if we are talking about systemic or pulmonary saturation. You have to be clear and keen about such a statement. One has to be very keen about such a statement. one has to be very keen about such a statement. Yeah. Then some other thing we would talk about, veins and arteries, some other difference. Let me see. Maybe I can talk about further about the valves, which we said in veins we don't have, sorry, in veins we have valves. The reason why we have valves in veins, we already illustrated it, because the pressure in veins is very low, so there is a high probability of backflow of blood. So our body had to adapt by the help of evolution, and we developed valves in our veins in order to prevent backflow of blood. But when we look at the case of our arteries, the arteries, they don't have valves. Why? Blood is moving at a very high pressure, so no need for valves. There is no backflow. Then two, we don't want to alter our blood pressure. We don't want our blood pressure to become low, because we require it in ultrafiltration at the capillary site in order to form tissue fluid. We shall see that further in some other further topics, like the lymphatic system. The lymphatic system, we shall be explaining how tissue fluid is formed in particular. Then one thing I could talk about is nervous supply and blood vessel supply to our arteries and veins. Actually, the arteries and veins, the tissues, the cells within the tissues, within the layers of the arteries and vein, do not use directly on the blood they are transporting. They don't use on the blood they are transporting. Why? Because of the thick layers. They don't use directly on the blood they are transporting. But they are also supplied with blood vessels. So the arteries and veins, their walls are also supplied with blood vessels. In order to nourish their walls. Because at times their walls also need oxygen. They also need nutrients in order to undergo constriction and vasoconstriction and vasodilation. In particular, when we look at the artery, unlike the veins, they are supplied with nerves. Nerves, those are the sympathetic nervous system, and at times the parasympathetic nervous system. So these nerves are very essential in vasoconstriction and vasodilation. So with stimulation from certain centers in the brain, arteries can undergo vasoconstriction and they can also undergo vasodilation. So they can reduce their diameter and they can also increase their diameter by the help of the nerve stimulation from the nerves supplying them to blood supply, which supplies with enough oxygen and nutrients, which is very essential in the formation of energy required for the vasoconstriction process. Thank you very much. I'm Clinician Grundroven. Don't forget to like and subscribe. It will be so supportive to the channel so that we create more content. Let's learn together.